You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Years from now, I think we can meditate and wonder whether our descendants, because I think they'll still be here, what they will think about us. And let us hope that at least they will give us the benefit of the doubt.
President Franklin D. Roosevelt's speech at the dedication of Mount Rushmore's Jefferson sculpture was off the cuff. It's a moment of FDR eloquently thinking out loud and showing the charm and optimism he was known for then and remembered for now. He's talking to the crowd, but he's also talking to us and to those who will be here when we are gone.
That they will believe that we have honestly striven in our day and generation to preserve for our descendants a decent land to live in and a decent form of government to operate under.
Photographs, movies, and sound recordings connect the past to the present and the future, provided they are not lost. In South Dakota, museums and organizations like the Homestake Adams Research and Cultural Center in Deadwood and the South Dakota State Historical Society in Pierre acquire, preserve, and archive pictures, film, and other media artifacts on a relatively large scale. But South Dakota also has a number of private collectors. Black Hills native Wayne Paananen owns the Historical Footprints Media Production Company in Lead. Paananen started producing historical and promotional videos in and around the Black Hills in the late 1980s. His work put him in touch with noted South Dakota historians like Watson Parker and Rex Allen Smith, recognized as the preeminent authority on the carving of Mount Rushmore. Telling Black Hills stories was a continuous process of finding and presenting historical images, whether they were in the possession of museums, private businesses, or individuals. Paananen says his interest in old film in particular got a boost when family friend and Deadwood businessman Don Clouser gave him just a few items from his own sizable collection of historical artifacts. They were old films rescued from a dark corner of an old Deadwood movie theater.
They were pristine material from the early 1900s, 1912, 1913, 14. And all of a sudden, a light bulb went on in my head of, I want more of this.
Some of the films were promotional films intended to bring visitors, new residents, and even new businesses into the Black Hills. Others were newsreels. It's likely that they were shown in the theater before the start of the feature film. Paananen's collection also includes a number of more recent films, images, and videos. He says the value of a film shouldn't necessarily depend on its age.
What's really important is not so much today, but what this material is going to mean another 50, 100 years from now, where people can look back. If we could look back to the Pilgrim's Landing or the Civil War, the different images we would pick up, because film can only do what film does.
What follows is a small sampling of historical film and images from Paananen's Historical Footprints collection.
Mm-hmm.
This short film clip predates the building of the first road through Spearfish Canyon, and it is believed to be among the first motion pictures ever shot in the Black Hills. The building in the background is on the site of the current Latch String Inn. This view of the Spearfish Fairgrounds looks west to east over Spearfish Creek. Panning south to north, the camera follows the path of today's Interstate 90 at the base of the ridge in the distance. Spearfish Normal School was a teacher's college, educating both men and women. The town's grade school was part of the campus. Black Hills State University now stands on the site. Established in 1896, the still operational facility is now a National Historic Site. The building in the background is today's Von Bayer Museum of Fish Culture. This bustling Main Street scene was likely shot as a promotion for Spearfish and its thriving downtown. Events and celebrations were also a popular subject. Matty Goff retired from professional rodeo in 1930 after a 9-year career. She married Maynard Newcomb and raised a family on a Meade County ranch. Matty Goff Newcomb is honored at the National Cowboy Hall of Fame, the National Cowgirl Hall of Fame, the South Dakota Hall of Fame, and the Casey Tibbs Rodeo Museum in Fort Pierre. She died in 2005 at her home in Sturgis. Deadwood's Days of 76 parade began in 1924 as a celebration of the town's frontier heritage. The event is still held every summer. Custer, South Dakota had been celebrating Gold Discovery Days for 9 years when this film was shot. The festival is still held every summer. Color films were expensive and rare in those days, even for Hollywood features. This is a Martin B-10, or a later variant of the original 1933 model. The B-10 was the U.S. Army's first all-metal monoplane bomber. It was removed from service during World War II in favor of the more powerful B-17. This is a Stearman Hammond Model Y. The prototype of this aircraft was built in 1936. It was supposed to be an inexpensive airplane that anyone could fly. The idea didn't take off. Only 20 were ever built. This Ryanair STA was built in 1936 as a high-performance, stunt-capable single-seater. An online listing of FAA tail numbers indicate that the aircraft now resides in California.
And now we're entering Custer State Park, the largest and one of the most spectacular state parks in the country. Let's climb right to the top of this Fire Ranger lookout tower perched on Mount Coolidge, from which we can get some idea of the extent of the park. For nearly everything, as far as the eye can see, is located within its bounds.
A 1938 tourism promotional film produced by the Chicago and Northwestern Railroad would likely have been shown in movie theaters all over the U.S.
Even the shelter houses, located at strategic points throughout the park, are constructed of massive logs and rocks in accordance with approved national park design, so as to blend with their natural surroundings. Now we are on the shores of one of the beautiful little lakes which dot this part of the country. And this one is called Stockade Lake, because it was near here that the famous Gordon Stockade, of which this is a faithful replica, was erected in the winter of 1874 as a protection against Indian attacks on a small party of 26 men and one woman, which came out here in search of gold. This simple monument is erected in memory of one of that group, Mrs. Annie Talent, who was the first white woman to live in the Black Hills. Now let's take a drive and see some of the many beauties of the park. As we pass through these natural rock gates, we see Harney Peak in the distance, its bold pinnacles and shoulders of bare granite rising above the pine forest to form an inspiring picture. The highest mountain in America east of the Rockies, and rises 7,242 feet above sea level. Nestling in the hills not far from here is Sylvan Lake, one of the most exquisite little lakes you will find anywhere, a perfect gem and an ideal spot at which to vacation. There is fine fishing in the lake and nearby streams, excellent boating and bathing, and innumerable woodland trails that beckon the hiker and rider. These are members of another of the Northwestern tour parties, returning ride through the mountains, to the hotel, which is hidden high on the hillside, and at which they will spend the night. Now we're on our way again, following a road that winds through some of the most picturesque country in the Black Hills, with beautiful vistas at every turn, both walls up on both sides, and sometimes would even block our way were it not for a tunnel that has been blasted through the solid rock. Then spread before us are vast stretches of wild and rugged country, extending for miles. Everywhere we find exciting and glorious views. We are on the renowned Needles Highway, acknowledged to be one of the outstanding scenic drives of the world, and so named from the giant pinnacles of granite that stand as if on guard. Geologists believe that these formations are among the oldest on Earth, and probably looked much the same as you see long before the Rockies and Andes came into being. As we gaze at these impressive needles of granite and realize that they are but the stubby remains of once mighty mountains, which have been worn down to their present size by the action of wind and water for hundreds of millions of years, we find them a particularly inspiring, provoking sight. Near here is the State Game Lodge, which in 1927 enjoyed the distinction of being the summer White House, for it was here that President and Mrs. Coolidge spent their vacation.
Resources for teachers, including lesson plans and suggestions for student activities, are available in SDPB's Digital Learning Library via www.sdpb.org/images-of-the-past.
Their curiosity will sometimes hold them nearly motionless. And of course, there are buffalo, or American bison, if you wish to be correct about the name. But it is as buffalo that they were known when the white men first came to this part of the country. They are as closely associated with the early history of the West as the Indians and cowboys and covered wagons. They were hunted very nearly to extinction before the few survivors were carefully protected and allowed to grow numerous again. Right here in Custer State Park, over 300 roam the hills. And in Wind Cave National Park, there's another herd of about the same size. Should you happen to be here at the right time, you may witness or even take part in a unique event, the world's only buffalo roundup. Everyone in the neighborhood who can ride is invited to join with the park rangers, and it is a thrilling sport to hunt out and chase these huge animals across the country. As group after group is added to the main body, the riders are sometimes hard put to keep them together, but eventually they are circled around and headed for the long chute leading to the corral. Here comes a section of the herd thundering down the runway now. Look at the young ones. When the dust settles, they are inspected and counted before being turned loose again. After the drive, the amateur cowboys find many exciting incidents to discuss as they rest their horses before going home.
Skiing at Terry Peak began in the 1930s as a club activity. The slope saw little use during World War II when some club members were fighting overseas as ski troops. Custer State Park visitors and employees are featured in this clip from the 1950s. President Dwight Eisenhower came to Mount Rushmore to address a National Assembly of Young Republicans. Eisenhower stayed in the Black Hills long enough to do a little fishing in Custer State Park. President John F. Kennedy visited Pier for the dedication of power online at Owyhee Dam. Kennedy and then-Senate candidate George McGovern were already acquainted from McGovern's time in the House of Representatives and in the White House as Kennedy's Food for Peace program head.
Hi, everybody. This is Kurt Gowdy. Right now, we're in Howard, South Dakota. A small town of about 1,500 people, 70 miles northwest of Sioux Falls. Howard calls itself the pheasant capital of the world. Right now we're talking to you in mid-morning. This is P-Day in South Dakota, the opening of the pheasant season.
This episode featured actor Robert Stack,
a former national 20-gauge champion, three times on the All-American skeet team, holds two world records, and incidentally, during World War II, Bob Stack was a gunnery officer.
And World War II heroes Joe Foss and General James Doolittle,
who led the bombing attack on Tokyo, one of the epics of American history. And the general's quite a sportsman and shot himself, isn't he, Joe?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, he's the best. The way he gets around after those mountain sheep, he does better than the mountain goats.
General, you've come to South Dakota pheasant hunting many times, haven't you?
I haven't been here, but I've been up in the north. I'm delighted to have this opportunity to be with you. But don't believe what Joe says about my shooting. I love to miss.
Now watch this one. And a beautiful shot it was. We had many other members of our party who helped make this hunt a lot of fun and even more enjoyable. Sid Davidson, Bob Thompson, Mock and Bob Brewer, Justin Berger and Gordy Edmond. They were truly great hosts.
Do you have images of the past that you'd like to share? You can do it online at www.sdpb.org. Look for the Share Your Photos and Stories link.